It's probably the small, it's amazing thing that is important. Turn about, Father, we come before you this morning. Thank you for another day. Thank you for your loving kindness. Thank you, Lord God, for your tender mercies. Thank you, Lord God, for the strength in our bodies. And so, God, now I pray that your people would be attentive to your word. I pray, oh God, that it would find a place in their hearts. I pray, oh God, that the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart would be acceptable in your sight. Oh, Lord God, you are my strength. You are our Redeemer, and you are our soon coming King. We love you, Lord God, today. These and all things we do ask in the precious and powerful name of the Lord Jesus Christ. And let all the people of God say, Amen. There are many things in life that cause us to be overjoyed, amazed, and sometimes surprised, especially when they happen unexpectedly. But there is nothing like the things that children do and say that can catch us totally off guard. There used to be a show on television called Kids Say the Darndest Things, and you never knew what you were going to hear whenever that show came on. I used to watch it with my children when they were younger. But I wish there was a camera here last Sunday when an amazing thing happened during our children's message. It was a teaching moment that I wish I could have, that could have been captured on video. If you all were here, you may have witnessed it, but you may not have gotten the total gist of what was going on. And for those that were not here, let me tell you the story. When the children came up last week, as is my normal practice, I give them an opportunity to give their offering. When it was done, or at least when I thought it was done, I put the plates back and walked down to discover that Liam, Scott's father, a little 3-year-old, I believe, was crying profusely. When I noticed that he was crying, I immediately asked what was wrong. And while I was doing that, his mother, Erin, ran up and scooped him up. But the next thing I knew, he was back again. But this time, he did not go up to sit with the children on the platform. He just stopped near me, still crying. And so I asked him what was wrong. He tried to tell me, but he was crying so hard that I could not understand him. Again, his mother came and saved the day, but this time with a dollar in her hand and said to him, here, put this in. But to my amazement, I got the plate and he put the dollar in and every tear immediately dried up from his eyes. I was overjoyed that he did that, and it was indeed a teaching moment from a child, unexpected and amazing. I have never seen that before happen in my life. In our text today, Dr. Luke tells us about an encounter with a man that has Jesus totally amazed. You would think that Jesus had seen it all, but apparently not. Two instances are cited in the Gospels where Jesus is shocked and amazed. Once in Mark chapter 6, Jesus is teaching in his own hometown of Nazareth, where he is rejected by his own people, and also he is dumbfounded and stunned at their unbelief. He is stunned at their lack of faith. It was surprising to him because he expected them to have faith. Now today in Luke 7, Jesus is astonished, he is amazed, and he is stunned again. This time though, by just the opposite, he is flabbergasted at a Roman centurion's amazing faith. So who is this man of such faith who causes Jesus to stop in his tracks and marvel? From Luke chapter 7 verse 2, we learn that he is a centurion. This is a Roman soldier. Now he is in charge. He's not only a soldier, but he is also in charge of 100 soldiers. He is a foreigner. He is a Gentile. He is a non-Israelite. The Romans were considered to be hostile to the Jews, but yet what we see here is abnormal. The Roman soldier is humble. He He respects the Jewish people and their faith so much that he is a large donor. He builds a synagogue for them. But he does not consider himself even worthy for Jesus to come and enter his home or worthy enough to approach Jesus directly. Matthew's gospel also records this encounter, but he omits some of the details that do not fit within his purpose for writing them. The style and audience for Luke and Matthew are very different. And so Matthew's gospel is written to the Jews and records the account, but would not want to highlight all of the details about a Gentile, where Luke is writing to the Gentiles and wants to give all of the details concerning this centurion and how Jesus responds to him. The other thing that is of note about this centurion is that he has a servant who is ill. It is said that there are three things that you never want to hear from your physician. You never want to hear oops. You never want to hear I have seen this before. And you never want to hear, oh, this is bad. Luke is a doctor, though, who said the third one here. He said, this servant has it bad. In fact, what Luke said is that the centurion servant was sick, but not only sick, he said he was ready to die. Now, this too was unusual for a man of the caliber of the centurion to even care about this servant. Sometimes they were seen as property, and if sick and not able to work, they were not considered to be much good. But in verse 3, it tells us, so when he, the centurion, heard about Jesus, he sent the Jewish elders to plead with him to come and heal his servant. Now, the centurion was not religious by any means, but the Jewish elders were. And it was surprising that they went to plead with Jesus. Now, speaking about being religious, by being religious, it is not synonymous with having faith in Jesus. I officiated a funeral last week for a woman who has not attended this church for over 15 years. And when I talked to her son immediately about his mother and his family, he went on to tell me during the conversation that they were not very religious. But at the funeral, I was able to tell him that Jesus did not even like religious people too much. In fact, it was religious people that hated Jesus and gave him the hardest time. They loved their rules, but not people. The Pharisees were religious, but they hated Jesus. So what does that tell you? Jesus is moved by faith, not by being religious. The religious people always questioned his authority. They were always suspicious of where he got his knowledge from. It is not so bad that they questioned him, but it is that they did not believe that he had authority from heaven. They questioned him when he taught in the synagogue. When Jesus forgave sin, they said, you don't have the authority or the right to forgive sin. When he would lay hands on a dead person, they claimed that he could not do that. Otherwise, he would be unclean. They ridiculed him even when he healed someone on the Sabbath. And Jesus turned it around on them and asked, would you rescue one of your animals on the Sabbath and yet not want a man's withered hand to be healed? They love their rules more than people. Jesus told them that he is the Lord of the Sabbath. It was all about power and authority. Whose authority was he operating in? Was it his own, or had he been authorized? So verse number 4 and 5 of chapter 7 of the text gives us a clue as to why the elders and the Pharisees, who were religious, did not like Jesus or believe in him. But they went to Jesus and listened to what they said. And when they came to Jesus, they begged him earnestly, saying that the one for whom he should do this was deserving. He was talking about the centurion, saying that the centurion was worthy and deserving, and that is why they wanted Jesus to come to his house. They said, well, he loves our nation. He has built us a synagogue. Now, what did they mean by he was worthy? Hearing from someone who has received a worthy award from a rabbi, he explains that what was meant by this is what the centurion, in their eyes, was worthy or deserving because he had done something good for them, the Jewish nation. He had given them large sums of money. He had built them a temple. That is the basis by which they summoned Jesus. So in their eyes, the man was deserving of Jesus' attention. The centurion, though, had the good sense to clear the matter up by then sending some friends to Jesus to clarify his position. And so he basically said this to Jesus: I did not ask you to come based upon my own goodness or my own worthiness. I asked you to come because I understand authority. And I believe that you can exercise your authority and bring good results. Just like my soldiers have to obey me, if I tell them to go, they go. If I tell them to come, they come. If I tell them to do this or that, they will do it. This was his argument. And this too should be a teaching moment for the Jews to understand that perhaps the centurion gave because of his faith in God, and not because he expected favors. Maybe he gave with the heart of little Liam that brought a dollar last week. You see, we should all tithe to God, but whether our tithe is a dollar or $1,000, it is the motive that is at the very heart of the matter. We give because we have faith. We don't give to then turn around and expect that God owes us a favor. This is what the elders miss. God heals because he is compassionate, and God responds to us based upon our faith through his grace. Two different perspectives. The Jewish elders saw good works, and Jesus saw faith that led to good works. It was an amazing thing. Jesus then turns to the crowd in verse 9, and he says, I tell you, not even in Israel have I found such faith. You see, amazing faith is a firm and certain conviction of God's goodness toward us, not based on merit, but based on grace alone. Jesus was sent to the lost sheep of Israel. They were expected to have faith, but not the centurion. This is what made his faith so amazing. He had an attitude of humility. He did not think that he was deserving of any special favors from the Jews or from God. He did not even think he was worthy to stand in Jesus' presence. Though he was an important man, he understood his place. He demanded nothing but pled for grace. He also recognized Jesus' authority, which means that he listened to the way Jesus taught. And he knew that Jesus was God in the flesh, sent from above. He knew that he could trust him because he himself had authority over some earthly matters. But Jesus had authority in heaven and in earth. He recognized also the power of the spoken word. He said to Jesus, just speak the word. When he heard what the elders were saying about him, he immediately let it be known that it was his faith that was at work. Have you ever thought of how powerful a word spoken at just the right time is? A word spoken at just the right time can be powerful in other ways. It can also bring healing to broken hearts. It can help those in despair. But at the end of the day, the text clearly helps us to see that it is faith that pleases God, and it is faith that causes us to act and to do things for God. These final words Jesus said to the centurion: go your way, as you have believed, so let it be done for you. And his servant was healed that same hour. Now, I don't know exactly what was in little Liam's mind on last Sunday when he came forth and gave his money, but I do see in him the heart that was in the centurion. The centurion was not expecting a favor. Liam did not wait after he gave his dollar. He did not wait for a hug. He did not wait for accolades. In fact, most of us laughed because when we finally got it, I think we were as amazed as Jesus was at the centurion. Isn't that an attitude that you and I need to adopt? To believe that God is a God that gives to us because of his grace, not because necessarily of what we give to him. You know, we owe God all of our lives, so because we give him a dollar, $10, $1,000, does that mean anything really to God in the grand scheme of things? We give to God because we love God. We give to God because we cannot beat God's giving. We give to God because God has given to us a life that we had never paid him for. Wouldn't it be something if God said to us, pay me for the breath that you breathe that is mine? We could never pay. And so my message to you today is I believe that we need to have the attitude of William. We need to have the attitude of the centurion. To be thankful and grateful to God for all that we have and all that God allows us to give back to him. Little Liam nor the centurion were not saying, I'm deserving of something now, church, give me something. No, they were not saying that. They were just coming with a heart of gratitude. And so today, I want to remind us to always keep in mind that none of us are worthy, none of us are deserving. Whatever we do for God, it must be because we love him. God wants us to have amazing faith. And if this centurion has taught us anything, it is for us to remember that God asks us to have amazing faith so that he can show us his amazing grace. That is what God loves to do. Amen? Amen. Praise God for his word. Let us pray. Lord, we thank you today for your goodness. We thank you today, God, for your loving kindness. We thank you, God, for the teaching moments. We thank you for the things that we can learn from children. We thank you for the things that we can learn in unexpected places. We thank you, Lord, for the centurion who was not expected to have faith, and yet he showed great faith in what he gave and what he does. He showed great faith in hearing God's word and just simply believing. Lord, help us to believe that way. Help us to demonstrate that kind of faith. Like little Liam walked out last week without his money and was sad that he did not have anything to give. Lord, help us to know that we owe you our very lives. And help us, oh God, to love you with all of our hearts and to serve you until the day that you come back for your church. We love you today, oh God, and I pray if there is anyone under the sound of my voice that does not know you, Lord God, in the pardon of their sins, I pray that they would ask you even now, Lord Jesus, come into my heart. Make your presence known in me. Father, we do thank you. We praise you. We love, honor, and adore you. And Lord God, I pray that you would bless us in the days ahead with such an attitude of amazing faith so that you might show us your amazing grace. Thank you now. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you.
Thank you.